Hello student, welcome to the second part of the analysis of Alfred Tennyson's famous poem, The Lotus Eaters. In this video, I have come up with more useful information for you, which will help you solve your 1 mark and 5 mark questions. In my last video on Alfred Tennyson's Lotus Eaters, I had talked about in detail of the important ideas that Tennyson tries to discuss in his poem. In this video, I shall be giving you some important facts and a simple analysis of the poem, which will help you solve the 1 mark and the 5 mark questions, as well as be of help to attempt a critical appreciation of this poem, The Lotus Eaters. Well, first let us look up the important facts. As I told you earlier, The Lotus Eaters was published in 1832 and it is one of Tennyson's most popular poems. Tennyson is one of the most famous poets of the Victorian age. The Lotus Eaters is based on an incident which has been taken from the famous ancient Greek poet Homer's beautiful epic called the Odyssey. This is what you have to remember, that The Lotus Eaters is based on an incident which Tennyson has picked up from Homer's beautiful epic, The Odyssey. The chief character of this epic, The Odyssey, is Odysseus, and he is also popularly known as Ulysses. Odysseus, also known as Ulysses, is the chief protagonist of Homer's epic Odyssey. Tennyson has used this epic by Homer to compose 2 of his very popular poems. He has written Ulysses and the Lotus Eaters, which are based on the character of Odysseus. Now, I want to tell you a little about the story of Odysseus, which will help you in understanding the poem more clearly and in a better way. Odysseus was the king of Ithaca and he was married to Penelope, and the name of their son was Telemachus. Odysseus left his kingdom Ithaca as he had to go to fight the war of Troy, or the Trojan War. He was away from Ithaca for almost 20 years. So, in the poem, you will find that he is returning home after almost 20 years, and he and his sailors believe that a lot must have changed in the land of Ithaca, or his kingdom of Ithaca. During the Trojan War, Odysseus, or Ulysses, as I keep telling you, his other name is Ulysses, he displays a lot of heroism, and when he is returning to Ithaca after the end of the war, it is during his journey back home that Odysseus experiences a lot of adventures which many poets, along with Tennyson, have used as the subject or the basis of their poems. So, Odysseus experiences the most memorable adventures during his long and hard and arduous journey by ship back to his kingdom along with his fellow soldiers. It is during one such journey that they are hit by a strong storm, and accidentally they reach the shores of the Lotus Island. It is at this point that Tennyson's poem, The Lotus Eaters, begins. Tennyson uses this incident as the basis of his poem, The Lotus Eaters. When they reach the land of the Lotus Eaters, the natives of the Lotus Island offer Odysseus and his men lotus fruits and flowers. All the sailors, all the brave soldiers of Odysseus eat these fruits and flowers, and the effect of the fruits and flowers of lotus is so intoxicating that it puts all the sailors in a mood of laziness and indolence. It is as if they have been charmed or some kind of a spell has been put upon them. The Lotus Island has a mesmerizing natural beauty. In the entire poem, you will find a very slow musical description of the beautiful afternoon on the Lotus Island. It seems that even the sun is setting very slowly on this island. Everything is moving in a very slow, languorous and an indolent or a lazy speed or phase. And so the natural beauty is very noteworthy in the poem. This natural beauty puts the sailors in a spell or charm, and they actually decide that they do not want to undertake their journey back to their home in Ithaca, and they want to live the rest of their lives on this island. Tennyson uses this incident to express a mood of weariness in which human beings feel that there is no use in toiling in life when death is the end of all. Okay? Tennyson expresses this mood of the sailors who believe that they have struggled and toiled and undergone harsh experiences all throughout their lives, and now they need a break. Now they need to sit back and relax, especially when they have begun to believe that however hard you work, the end of life is death. This is the central tension that underlies the poem. There is a philosophical tone in the poem from this point onwards, when there is this conflict going on between the sailors, whether they should live an easy, inactive life or whether they should go back to their brave and active life full of adventure. So the central thought of the poem is that the poem examines the conflict between a sense of responsibility and the desire to live only for oneself and experience pleasure or a life full of toil, as opposed to an inactive life. In my earlier video, I told you that Odysseus always was in favor of a very active life, exploring new lands, learning new things, and never sitting back to relax. Whereas in the poem, we find that his sailors who thought like him now feel just the opposite. Well, the poem begins with Odysseus commanding his men to have courage because their ship is being hit by a storm, and they feel that they will soon find a shore on which they will land. They do so almost immediately, and it enchants them with its outworldly, natural and mesmerizing beauty. There are valleys, snowy mountains and cliffs that are covered in streams. It is so beautiful that the sailors decide to stay back on this island and not to go back home. The poem is divided into two parts, and the second half of the poem is made up of the choric song. A choric song is a song which is sung by a group of people. Here, the group of people are the sailors of Odysseus. In this song, the men describe all the reasons that they want to remain on the, why they want to remain on the island. They do not think that it is fair that they should have to labor their whole lives while no other being is forced into the same fate. As human, this is what their lives consist of, and they no longer want to take part. They confess that what they want most is a life in which they relax until their death. So, this is the kind of mood that sets into the poem in the choric song. While the men are discussing and debating whether they should keep on experiencing the pleasures that they are experiencing on the island, or whether they should go back home. So there is a little sense of guilt also in their minds. However, they do mention their wives and the homes they are thinking of abandoning, but they believe that their families will be better off without them at this point. Remember, I told you that most of them are returning home after a 20-year journey to Troy, the war, and back. So, they believe a lot must have changed, their children must have grown up, their children must be ready to assume their responsibilities, and so they see no point in going back to their homeland. Life has moved on, and their return would only cause more problems. They are content to live as they believe the gods do, as the gods do in their valleys of Asphodel, and look out on human misery. They also decide that they will make no effort to intervene or help. The poem concludes with the men stating once more, reassuring one another that their wanderings and their travels are now finished, and now they will not travel anymore, and they will stay here. In the last stanza of the second half of the poem, the men confess to new desires, and this stanza describes how they sit down on the yellow sand and keep on discussing, giving the reasons why they should continue living in the Lotus Island. They turned to one another and said that they would return no more. They did not want to return to the arduous 10-year journey. They state that the island Ithaca is far beyond the wave. It is too far for them to reach or even try to get back. And now they are so happy with this indolent, languorous life of inactivity and inertia that they do not want to go back home. The men are rejecting their previous lives of hard work and struggle in favor of one in which they will only rest. They no longer want to be thrown from sorrow to sorrow, nor ever have to stop doing as they please in favor of working. In the fourth stanza, the speakers are bemoaning the fact that we are all heading towards death and must labor on the way. They do not believe that life should be completely made up of labor. They want to be left totally alone, unbothered by the real world. They believe that their lives are moving very quickly and death will soon approach. While they are still alive, they want to be left alone and have nothing else taken from them. There is no point that they can see in fighting wars against evil, as there is no pleasure in it. Nothing in the world is going to last, so why waste their time making dreadful enemies? By the end of the stanza, they have come to the conclusion that it is better to just die now rather than to live a life of labor. They conclude the poem by restating that surely slumber is sweeter than toil, and by reassuring one another that they will cease their wanders from now on. As I told you, that the central underlying tension of the poem is that whether one should be more socially responsible in throughout one's lifetime, whether one should never forget one's duties towards his family, his society and his homeland, or one has the right to live for himself, enjoy life's pleasures without having to work or toil or be miserable. This is the central contradiction or the central conflict that is going on in a parallel way in the entire poem. As I told you, Ulysses was in favor of being active, socially responsible, and forever learning and gaining more knowledge, while his sailors in this poem think otherwise. So, in the myth on which this poem is based, Odysseus, having not eaten from the lotus plants, is forced to carry his men back onto the ship and single-handedly sail away from the island. The men eventually come to their senses once the magic of the plant has worn off. It is a very symbolic end, because we do have momentary phases in our life when we kind of surrender before pleasures and inactivity. But after a while, when that momentary phase is over, we again realize the duties that we have to fulfill and the tasks which remain undone and which we have to complete before we end this journey of life. I hope this information was even more useful for you, and it will really help you understand the poem better. This is an important poem, so please watch both the videos as they will be helpful to you. Keep watching, and thank you until I take up a discussion of yet another poem of your course. Thank you.